Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent guest and leader for you. But before I go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel and check all the magnificent previous content. And also let me acknowledge our partners, the digital health platform Clinitouch V and our industry partner, Isaac Kerr. But let me introduce you to Dr. Ami Bhatt. She is the director of Massachusetts General Hospitals of Adult Congenital Heart Disease. She is also an associate professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School and the chief innovation officer at the American College of Cardiology. Ami, how are you?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm great.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for accepting the invite. Previous to the recording, I was saying you're one of these people that I follow your work. I feel like I know you, but we never really spoke.
It's amazing how that happens, especially over the past 2 years. I have so many people I would consider good friends who I've never actually met face to face just yet. Hopefully that will change.
Yes, I'm so happy that we are here. I'm going to go straight to the topic and the questions. Is that okay?
Absolutely.
So we are here today to discuss consumerism as patient agency. And the first question that I have for you is, can you explain and define what is patient consumerism?
Absolutely. So I think one thing that has happened, especially in the digital health and wearable space, is that there's a conception that now patients or individuals are really interested in monitoring their own information. At first, it was heart rate tracking related to athletics or walking or steps, and it's also oxygen saturation. Increasingly, it's blood pressure now or weight scales, even sleep, and then important diagnoses that are medical, right? So for diabetes, continuous glucose monitoring. And one of the trends that I am noticing is a tendency towards talking about that with the phrase consumerism, consumerism in healthcare, people wanting to buy more things, measure more things. But there's a little bit of a negative connotation from the clinical side as to what that means. And what I would love for us to do is to reframe how we are talking about individuals measuring their own selves and think about it as patient agency. This is a whole new world where instead of being paternalistic, patients are saying, I want to know more about myself, my body, and how it works. And it should be something that we learn to celebrate. But that requires a little bit of readjustment in the way we think about it. And so that's why I was hoping today we could talk about this phrase, which is, it's not consumerism, it's really patient agency. And how do we start thinking about what that means? And then really frame, how do we interact as clinicians, as industry, as companies, as payers with individuals, and have it become a positive part of the experience of measuring your health that everybody thinks is good. And so I think that was kind of what I was getting at with this phrase.
No, that's brilliant. It's a very new kind of terminology. You also know that I am a digital health influencer and a very, very strong advocate for wearables and health as a whole. So this is a fantastic discussion also that we shed some light around certain behaviors, around, of course, the wearables and around the digital health piece as a whole. So this is fantastic. I'm going to move to the second question, which is, what role digital health has on impacting patient consumerism?
Yeah, so I think the great thing is when you think about digital health and what we're offering, we're coming to a place where as a multitude of organizations, right, whether you're talking about the American College of Cardiology, or we've been meeting with the Consumer Technology Association or the AMA, many of us, even the Digital Medicine Society, we've talked with them about this, really understand the importance of standards. Standards for digital medicine. How are we thinking about digital healthcare and what should it look like? So not just everybody's coming up with an idea, but is there a framework that really helps us care for patients? And I think that's where digital health can help consumers because it allows us to have an opportunity to really say, hey, look, I know you're looking for what the right things are for yourself. We can help you do that. You know, there's a lot of talk now about digital prescriptions, right? Mm-hmm. Should we be prescribing particular types of digital health monitoring for our patients? What does that look like? I always like the element of what do we not prescribe too? Because there are some patients where you say, you really don't need to be measuring your oxygenation every day. It's not at all relevant to your healthcare, right? And I had somebody come in the other day and just ask me, like, how often should I measure my O2 set? And I was like, not at all, because it's not relevant to anything about your health per se today. But looking at your sleep habits, looking at your heart rate, looking at your weight, those things could help with your overall health. So I think it's great to have standards. I think it's great to be able to prescribe and recommend things. And then I think it's also important to tell people, what do they not need to measure? Because we don't want to create a society that has health-related anxiety. And so we want to help people also understand what are the limits of what they should be measuring so that they don't start worrying about unnecessary things.
Brilliant. It is great that you actually mentioned this, the prescribing of health apps and mHealth in digital health. Because in here in UK, there is a big push around prescribing. The NHS, the National Health System, created a bit of a library quite a while ago, a big project for companies and also for GP surgeries to start to tap in into this big area. But there was no benchmarking. Now there is an organization very well known that is doing that type of work. And also in Germany, for example, very recently, they really pushed the digital health agenda forward with some reimbursement around prescribing digital health solutions and technology. Fantastic, fantastic area. This could be another episode in its own right. It's a really nice area. And the third and last question that I have for you, Ami, is I know that equity and diversity are topics close to your heart. And how can digital health help close the gaps?
Absolutely. So I think one of the most important things we think about is who are the people who we really need to focus on to make sure that both preventive care is emphasized and that chronic disease management is emphasized, right? And they're two slightly different areas, because then you change a little bit between wearables and then FDA-approved medical devices that are also digital health, right? And how can those help? The most important thing to understand is the underserved areas, not just in the UK or the US, but globally, are still areas where there is access, where there is smartphone access, and where in certain communities, at a minimum, there is sometimes even wireless access or broadband, right? Now, if it's an area that is missing some of the broadband access, we are increasingly able to give people even just the ability to measure themselves and report back to themselves. And that feedback of simply knowing, this is what my average heart rate is, such that when you are out of your average and you are feeling unwell, you are aware early that this is not normal and then can act upon that. And so there are all sorts of ranges of how an individual or a patient can have this agency over their own health. Sometimes it's just knowing where you usually are and knowing when you feel off. And that may just be enough to help you seek care, because there are a lot of people who just don't have the time, finance, travelability, or it's just not the most important thing in their daily job to think about preventive care for themselves. There are many too many things on people's plates to be able to put that as a priority. But if you know your trends and you know when it's off, that may be enough to trigger you to say something. If you have a chronic disease, or as most people do, multiple chronic diseases, especially in our aging population, then there's the opportunity to say, I can get feedback to myself, and perhaps I can even get feedback to my community, whether that is family members who want to know what's going on and you want to share data with them, or whether it's clinicians who you trust. I think there are two important things that come up. One is, there is a role for the technology companies we are working with to really be very conscious of what does it look like when data from many patients is coming back into a clinician, right? We cannot burn out clinicians further. I think that's actually where some of the negativeness towards consumerism comes from. If my patient sends me 1,000 Apple Watch tracings a day, what will I do, right? But I think the important part is the more patient agency that person has, the less likely they are to send you 1,000 tracings. So that education, digital education and health education is important. The company can help by saying, we have mechanisms, dashboards, we can highlight things that are out of range. We don't have to give you all the information. And then we can set standards. These are the right cases in which we should be using this. These are the cases in which if people want to use it, fine, but it wasn't digitally prescribed. So that's just you looking after yourself. And here are some chronic disease populations where we're not getting it right, where hypertension globally is out of control and yet is one of those things that we don't need to bring patients into a hospital to measure. There are areas where we can make big strides in those populations at most risk simply by truly embracing measuring in the community where a patient lives, measuring at home and giving them agency. I think it's really important that, you know, organizations and shows like your own, your influence as a digital health influencer is one of the things that really allows many of us who work in the space to say, no, this is possible. It is happening. And we continue to therefore push for it because it's the right thing for our patients at the end of the day to be measured where they live.
Fantastic points there. Ami, thank you so much. You know, I'm a fan of wearables. I've done lots of research around wearables and the behavior. And one of the things that you just mentioned, apart from the standards, that the consumers report is the lack of guidance, is one of the biggest perceived barriers. And also the lack of education, guidance, education, direction. One of the things that I found in one study that I've done. So, yeah. We could talk about this for hours and hours.
No, I hear you. You know, some of the work that you've done, I will comment just for your audience. I'm sure they've all seen it too. But I think it leads to the concept that having a closed loop is helpful in some of these cases. So let me explain. The point is well taken. And what your research really does show is that if you just start measuring, then what, right? And how much education goes into then explaining what? But if there's a way to have a little bit of a closed loop, I get do some testing on myself. And then there's an ability for the system, for the individual tech, whatever that system might be, for a community partner to be able to feed back and say, this is good, this is not good. All I need is sick from not sick, risky from not risky. At the end of the day, we just need to start there. I don't need precision medicine. I just need to catch all those people who we're not catching. And so in a way, any closed feedback loop, whether that involves the patient alone and a technology, whether that involves a patient and a community center helping or a clinician, all of those are helpful in at least catching some percent of that population who has disease and we are missing them, especially those in the lower socioeconomic status, even globally, where it's just the health can't be a priority because just living is a priority, right? Poverty is a priority. Environment is a priority. So, you know, there's a lot that we can do still.
Brilliant. Ami, thank you so much. We came to the end of the episode. I'm not sure if you've seen it before. I finish with a peculiar question. It's not a question as such. It's called 1 minute of fame, where you can mention anything, your work, I mean, professional life, family life, I mean, anything whatsoever. Over to you to round up. 1 minute of fame.
Oh, 1 minute of fame. I would love to start with the dance team I just joined. It's a Bhangra dance team in Boston. So we got to call them out because everybody needs those things that just make them happy. And I think that's key to remember for the clinicians who are watching, for those who are tech, who are serial entrepreneurs, you know how hard life can be sometimes. So I'd say, remember to take time for yourself. So maybe that's not what makes me famous, but I want people to get that message. And then I guess, you know, 1 minute of fame and what I'm proud of is, the adult congenital heart disease that you mentioned, that field barely existed when I started. And it was a great opportunity to learn and grow and make something that's a well-established subspecialty now. And I really think that innovation in digital health is at that same stage. So I am excited to work with you and others together. But when we look back 10 years from now, this is going to be a fully vetted part of how medicine is practiced. And no one's ever going to know that it was something that people didn't accept. This is the future. We're headed there, and I'm proud to head there with everybody else who's watching today.
Brilliant, Dr. Ami. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for accepting the invite, for being in here, sharing these magnificent insights. I'm going to share in a body of the video your Twitter. You're very active. Please connect with Dr. Ami on Twitter, LinkedIn, follow her great work. And I'm going to round up now. Thank you so much for being in here.
Thanks for having me.
And to all our viewers and listeners, again, make sure you follow Dr. Ami's work. Also, subscribe to the channel. And let me acknowledge, finally, our partners, Digital Health Platform, CliniTouch V, and our industry partner, Isaac Care. And I'll see you all next week.